all of the latex printers are fantastic backlit printers. And there are lots of types of materials that qualify as backlits. Backlit can be a film, like a polyester film. And then within polyester film, you have several categories. A backlit can also be, say, a polycarbonate. A backlit can be an awning. A backlit can be a PET banner. A backlit can be a fabric. Anything really that you're putting a larger amount of ink on, because you're going to put it in some kind of window or light box, can in a way be called a backlit. It's essentially a translucent or a transmissive print. You're going to have light going through the material, which is going to reduce the color a little bit, and then it will afford it a beautiful looking resonant print because you're backlighting it or you're allowing natural sunlight to shine through, like in the case of a window. What I'm holding in my hand here is probably the most widely used and typical type of backlit for the latex printers. For doing most film backlits, like you see everywhere at airports or jewelry counters, this is what you're going to print on. There are many good choices here. This is an HP backlit. IntelliCoat makes a very nice one. An SBL7, that's on the media locator, as is this. Natura makes a nice backlit. City Light. Seal City Light's a nice backlit. I think the Seal Vivalux might be one of the best of its category, and that is a certified media. These backlits, these aqueous coated backlits, are specifically designed for aqueous printers. This is an aqueous printer. If you have a choice of backlits, one is aqueous, one is solvent, you choose the aqueous. The aqueous is going to be more appropriate to the type of printer this is. It is a water-based printer, not a solvent-based printer. Some people will buy solvent-coated or even UV-coated backlits and try to make them work on a latex printer. It may be possible to get those kind of backlits to work, but you're going to have some custom equipment and a spectrophotometer that can read transmissively like a Barbieri in order to do it. If you don't have that kind of equipment, steer clear of those backlits. They're not going to work effectively, and you're not going to have the tools to adjust the ink load to have any chance of printing on them. You are much better using the media locator, choosing a backlit that's on there, and then looking more for aqueous coateds, because aqueous coateds will work quite well in this printer. Aqueous coated backlits are the most common. Now, it has a coating on the film. That coating is designed to allow it to print more ink, and that heavy ink load is what gives it a beautiful resonant color when you illuminate it in an LED light box. This is what's most commonly used. Now, some people don't like the aqueous because it tends to be a little more scratch prone. It's not bad, but what's happening isn't the latex is scratching, it's that the coating can be scratched off the actual film. In those cases, they'll usually laminate, or they'll put it behind an acrylic face light box, and then once it's behind the light box, it doesn't matter. But I want to go over some other choices, which not only may be a little different types of materials, but in some cases, other material types may afford much better scratch resistance. It just kind of depends on what your expectations are and what you're looking for. Usually, most of the aqueous coated backlit is matte finish. It's usually a matte finish. That's why they're fairly uniform. But if you put them in an acrylic light box with a gloss acrylic face, then they become gloss, and so the matte finish doesn't matter. So let me move on to some other choices. This is made by a Korean film company called Natura, and this is the 680. It's a little glossier. They also have a 690, which is sort of a luster. The Natura 680 and 690 are interesting films, and I'm quite fond of them. They are both on the media locator, and they both print quite well. It affords a fairly heavy amount of ink, and I think the prints come out very, very nicely. They're also a little more scratch resistant, and they have a little more luster to them. So if I'm putting them in light boxes where I'm not going to have a lamination or I'm not going to have an acrylic face, these might be pretty good choices. The Natura backlits, also, Natura also sells one called BF600, which is an aqueous coated, and that is on the locator. Now this is a translucent. That is an adhesive vinyl by 3M. This is designed to go on an acrylic face, and then the face would be slid into a light box. So this is a self-adhesive backlit, and this is also on the media locator. This came out quite nicely. This is, as with all backlits, you're putting really more ink down than you need to put down, because if you were to look at it refractively, like a poster, it's over-inked. But once you put it in a light box and you turn that light on, now it's inked properly. It has the right amount of ink. If you put a front lid, a traditional front lid, in a backlit box, it'll look washed out. So usually with backlits, you're looking at 170% density up to, say, even 230% density. You want to have some ink down on there. That's what allows it to really sit in the light box and look fantastic when you turn a strong light inside it. Now, there are other choices I have here, and this is really quite new. This is a product by Tekra. It's called Jet Vue. This is, as you can see, is a very nice gloss. They also sell a matte finish if you prefer. Most people like this gloss. The virtue of this is the scratch resistance is just off the charts. I mean, you can go at it almost with a key and you're going to dent it before you scratch it. So this is going to perform very, very similarly to the Duratran or the Fujitran, and it very closely mimics the type of printing that those type of RGB contones print. Now, all of the backlits are going to run a little slower. You're going to be looking at 16 or 20 pass, depending on how much ink you need. That's just sort of the nature of backlit printing. You know, you have to put a lot of ink, and it's going to require you to slow the printer down a little. So this is at 20 pass, 54 square feet an hour. The colors are excellent, and the scratch resistance is magnificent. And then you have an Ultraflex PET backlit. So this is an Ultraflex PET, which is designed to be translucent, and you put this into a light box. Now, we built this one recently. This is not on the media locator. Hopefully it will be soon. But this is a PET backlit. So it's showing that not only can you print PET, but you can print PET with heavy ink loads and still have it look very, very nice. So this is another type of backlit. This is very similar to the PET, except it is an banner. This is the Vulite by Ultraflex. A very similar one, which is on the media locator, is the 3M Panographics, and that is also a backlit banner. These are used commonly in awnings. You would see them a lot in awning-type materials. They can take a lot of ink. They look excellent. I do recommend, if you're going to make awnings, I would probably put a liquid-based laminate on this, a water-based liquid laminate. The reason why is an awning is going to be outside for so long, and it's going to take so much abuse that if you have a long-term awning, I probably would put a liquid lam on it, much like you would put a cast lam film on a vehicle wrap. It's something that's got a lot of money in it, a lot of investment. The awning has a lot of fabrication, and you want to get as much life as possible. A simple water-based laminate will save the day. And I use water-based laminates mostly from Mirabu. And then lastly, we have a Lexan. And this is done as a backlit. You could do this as a frontlit or a backlit. So if I was to put it in a window, it's reverse printed. So it has imperviousness. The ink is actually on the inside. It's a clear. But if we were to print it reverse printed and it was in a window, it would function as sort of a backlit. If this were would be flooded with a white backer, then it would function as a frontlit and I wouldn't have to put as much ink down. You could put it as a normal ink load. But a lot of clears that we're experimenting with could serve either as a frontlit or a backlit depending on the application. The thing with backlits is, unless you have some fairly sophisticated and frankly expensive color equipment, most users of a Latex 300 series printers will not have that equipment to be able to make their own backlits. So we are trying to support as wide a selection of backlits in different types of categories as possible on the media locator, and then take those presets and have them work very effectively without having to have that equipment. We have that equipment. Now, the best way to deal with backlits is to go on the media locator, find a backlit that's on there, and then purchase it that way. That way you're not buying something that may or may not work, and then going through one preset after another, throwing it at them, see if you can make it work. There's a chance that it's incompatible with Latex, that it will not work. It will usually, what you'll see is things like re-wetting, where you print on it and everything seems dry, and then you take it off the take-up roll and it's all kind of greasy and stuck to itself. Yeah, that's re-wetting. And it's common among a solvent or a UV-coated backlit film. Most of those films are incompatible with latex. They're not going to work. And if they will work, you're really going to need the right equipment, as I said a little earlier. And that's not probably something you're going to have. So if you stick to the ones that are on the media locator, chances are you're going to be very pleased with the backlits on the latex.